One of my goals with this channel is to make as many people as possible feel excited about the power and flexibility of Lightroom's cloud-based ecosystem of apps. That's not to say that I have anything against Lightroom Classic. Not at all. It's just that I feel compelled to showcase all of the awesome reasons that come with using a cloud-based workflow to manage and edit your photos, especially when it comes to Lightroom's three surfaces: desktop, mobile, and web. And honestly, it's Lightroom Web that has me most excited because I believe it's the easiest entry point for someone who's altogether new to Lightroom or someone who's familiar with Lightroom Classic and wants to dip their toes into Lightroom's cloud ecosystem without having to install Lightroom Desktop. There are, of course, many more reasons to give Lightroom Web a shot, and one of them is something that you may not have considered: the ability to seamlessly connect to Photoshop Web to accomplish certain tasks that aren't yet available in any version of Lightroom. And that's exactly what I'm going to show you in this video. So let's dive in. All right, so here we are in Lightroom Web. And if you've ever used Lightroom Desktop, then this should be very familiar to you. The overall UI is very similar, and that's a good thing, especially because as a Lightroom Desktop user, I can just kind of navigate through this very, very easily. But we are, in fact, in a Chrome browser tab. And one quick note, Adobe does recommend using Chrome with Lightroom Web, but I've used Safari and Lightroom Web and had no problems. But because that's the recommended browser, that's what I'm going to use in this video. So let's go ahead and I'm just going to do an editing workflow. And part of the reason why I want to do that is because I want to show you the flexibility of Lightroom Web and just how powerful it is. Like, again, we have desktop grade editing tools here right in a web browser, and this continues to blow my mind. The first thing I want to do, though, is I'm just going to use Generative Remove, which is available in Lightroom Web, to get rid of a few different elements, and I'll walk you through them. So here, this is Generative Remove right there, same icon in Lightroom Desktop. And you'll want to make sure that you have use Generative AI enabled for Generative Remove. Otherwise, if it's unchecked, then you'll be using the Content Aware Remove brush, which is great for dust spots and little things like that. So let's go ahead and I'm going to start. I just want to remove that little thing back there and click on Apply. Let's turn off the overlay. And you can see it's gone. Looks great. Now, the next few things that I'm going to remove are, if you're a stock photographer, you'll appreciate this because, as you can see, if I wanted to upload this to a stock agency, this image as it is right now would get rejected in 2 seconds because it has various brand names. Here's Pontiac, there's the model of the car, and then there's the Pontiac logo. And so Generative Remove is an ideal tool to use in this situation. So let me show you how that works. I'm going to start with this right here, just draw there, and then click on Apply. There we go. It's like it never existed. Let's move on to the Pontiac brand. Let's click on Apply. Beautiful. And then let's get rid of the logo over here. And like with other versions of Generative Remove on Lightroom Desktop and Mobile and Classic, we do have variations. So you can see here we have three different variations. I think variation 2 is actually good here, so I'm going to stick with that. All right, now let's go ahead and just get some editing done. So let's go to the editing panel over here. I'm going to start by changing the profile. I really prefer Adobe Landscape. I usually use that as my starting point, and it just works for me. Now let's go ahead and we're going to make some basic tone changes. I'm going to open up the exposure, open up the highlights. Let's drop the shadows a bit. And I'm going to bring the white point a little bit closer here to the edge. Then let's open up the black point right around there. So you can see now what we've done is we've gotten just a nice baseline image in terms of tone. Now the other thing that I want to do is apply an S-curve. Again, if you've watched my editing videos, you know I am a huge fan of the S-curve. We have a point curve right here, so I'm going to drop a dot right here, drag up to boost the highlights. Let's go here. Deepen the shadows. Then let's go in the middle here and adjust midtones. Now, one of the things that I also like to do is take the black point up here. As I bring it up here, I'm introducing gray. Eventually, white will be introduced, which we don't want because that looks terrible. But a little bit of gray, I find, gives you that kind of vintagey look, which I think fits the overall theme of this photo. Now, there was a bit of saturation added with this point curve, so I'm going to reduce that saturation about 20%. In terms of white balance, we could also use a dropper here, and I'm just going to drop it in the sky. And you can see how that just warmed up a little bit. Let's park the dropper. And I'm going to add a little bit of vibrance and decrease the saturation a bit. Now, the image feels overall kind of warm. And so what I want to do is I'm actually going to go to color grading here, and I'm going to use a color grade for the shadows. And so what I'll do is I'm going to take this dot here and I'm going to bring it out all the way. And what this is showing us is the hue at 100% saturation. And so I'm basically looking for a color in the shadows. Like I'm actually looking in the shadows of this image because that's where this color grade is being affected. And then I'm finding the color I like somewhere right around here. And then I'm going to click on this dot, bring it to zero, and then just build it out. So somewhere right around there, I think adds a nice balance in terms of the warm tones throughout the image and then the cool color grade in the shadows. I can also adjust the luminance of the shadows here so I can make it darker or brighter. I'm actually going to make it a little bit brighter here. Somewhere around there looks good. And so that's looking good just overall with the global edits to the photo. But now I want to make some local edits. And again, we're in Lightroom Web, but that doesn't mean that we're missing out on some of Lightroom's most powerful tools, including adaptive masks. So here, this is the masking panel. And you can see we have all of the masks that we need right now. I'm going to start with clicking on Adaptive Sky. And so Lightroom has generated the mask over there. I'm going to go down here under Effects to Dehaze, and I'm going to add a little bit of that. You can see how as we go all the way out here, it's degrading the sky. I just want a little bit of definition in that top right corner. And the Dehaze slider does a really nice job of bringing that out. I'm also going to go ahead and drop the highlights just a bit in the sky there. It was getting a bit too hot for me in terms of the tone. Next, I want to make some edits directly to the car itself. And so I can either go ahead and select subject, or I can use the objects mask over here. So there are two different options here. You can either use a brush or a marquee tool, which is what I prefer here. And so I'm just going to make a rectangular selection around what I want, and Lightroom will make the selection based on that. And so you can see Lightroom does a beautiful job of selecting the car. And for the purposes of this mask, what I want to do is I want to cool it off. Like it just looked like as it gets warmer, it doesn't look right. I feel like as you cool it off, I think the car looks better here. Of course, I'm going to add a little bit of texture and clarity to the car just because it already has all that really rich detail. And of course, one of the things I realized I did not do yet was rename my masks. This is really important. I recommend doing this. Let's go ahead here. Let's rename this one. We're going to call this car mask. And then we'll go back here. This was our sky mask. So let's relabel that to sky mask, just so that we know what's what. And of course, all of these masks, every edit that we make will sync to the cloud and will be made available on all other versions of Lightroom, including desktop and mobile, which is phenomenal. Now I'm looking at the car and it is actually sticking out a bit too much to me. So I'm actually gonna darken it a bit. And it was a bit too much on that temperature slider. So right around there, it looks a little bit better. All right, cool. Let's go ahead, see what we've done so far. We can click on the eye icon here. This is our original. And then this is our edit. The final thing that I wanna do is I wanna bring out the greens in the foliage around the car. And I'm gonna use point color for that, which is one of my favorite tools. I'll link to another video where I dive into exactly how point color works at the end of this video. So be sure to check that out. I'm gonna start by clicking on the dropper here. I'm going to click on a color of green that I want to sample. So you can see right there. And this is global. This is for the entire image. I could use one of the masks with point color here, but I want to affect the entire image. So let's go ahead and start with a hue shift. Let's see if there's one direction or another. So right around there, it's looking good. Let's bring out the saturation a bit. And then let's adjust the luminance. Let's make it a bit brighter. Right around there. That looks really good. And actually, I'm going to bring that saturation down a bit, somewhere right around maybe there. Looks good. Okay, so for the most part now, I'm happy with this edit, but there's something that's been bothering me when I took this photo. And I couldn't really do anything about it until recently. And that was when Adobe introduced Generative Expand into the mix. And for now, at least, Generative Expand is in Photoshop. That's the only way that you can use it. And what I mean by that is, if you look on the right and bottom of the frame, it does kind of look like there's not enough breathing room. Like, it's the car is a bit too close to the edge of the frame, and I wish I had just a little bit more space there. Well, we can use Photoshop in a web browser to do that. I'm going to start by going to the share button up here, and you'll see there's this option called expand in Photoshop. So let's go ahead and click on that. And you'll see that Photoshop is launched in a new browser tab. And by default, we're brought into the crop tool, which is what we want to use with Generative Expand. I'm going to zoom out a bit so we can see more of the image. And so the first thing I want to do is make sure that this lock is enabled because this constrains the aspect ratio. And so I can drag from the bottom right here out. And I'm trying to visualize here, like, all right, how much space do I want? And I think this, maybe a little bit more, is enough. So now we've got our crop box expanded beyond the original image. I'm going to click on Generative Expand. And then I'm going to click on generate. And you can see we have more breathing room. This makes me feel better when I look at this image. Of course, we have three different variations here, so I can see maybe there's one that's better than the others. I mean, they're all good. So, let's see this first one, second one's good. I'm going to stick with this one. Now, we're not done because we're still in Photoshop and there are things that we can do here because we have this layered based workflow. One of the things that I love to do is apply an Orton effect, which adds kind of a glowy kind of saturation boost to the image. So let's go ahead. I'm going to click on this ellipsis here under the layers panel, and I'm just going to merge visible. So now we have one flat layer. Let's go ahead here, click again, and I'm going to select duplicate layer. Now, I have plenty of videos of how to apply the Orton effect using all different versions of Photoshop, but in Lightroom Web, with the two identical layer selected. With this top layer selected, I'm going to go to the adjust panel here and I'm going to select Gaussian blur. And then the amount of blur is kind of up to you. Different people will tell you different things in terms of like how much to apply. Just eyeball it. Like for me, anywhere usually between 35 and 40 works. I'll click on done up here. And then I'm going to change the blend mode to soft light. And so at 100%, this is kind of strong, but you can see the effect. In terms of here, let me zoom in a bit so you can see the effect more. I'm going to take the opacity slider, bring it to zero, and then just slowly build it in until I get that really nice kind of ethereal look to the photo. It adds a really nice glow. Now, of course, there are masking tools here. So if you want to control where the Orton effect is applied, you can use that, but I'm okay with it applied to the entire photo. And so you can see that we used Photoshop Web for a few things that we couldn't do in Lightroom. One was Generative Expand, and two was duplicate the layers so that we can apply an Orton effect. Again, all within a web browser, which is really, really cool. So now that we're done, all you need to do is click on Send to Lightroom to return this back to Lightroom. All right, so here we are back in Lightroom Web, and I added the image from Photoshop back into this album. So this is the original image that we edited just in Lightroom Web. And then this was the image that was returned from Photoshop Web. You can see we have a little bit more of that breathing room on the right and bottom and that really nice Orton effect. Now, of course, I can finish things up with a few more edits. Like I can go down here to sharpening, add a little bit of sharpening, and then I can expand this here and then remove sharpening from areas where I don't want it using the masking slider. I can also go ahead here, drop saturation overall just a bit. It was getting a bit too punchy for me. And then I can use the masking panel, add a radial gradient here. Just gonna draw one over the car and then click on invert. And what this will do is this will give me kind of a custom shaped vignette so I can draw the eye further to the car. Now let's go ahead and rename that to custom vignette. And we are good to go. Again, the reason why I love creating these videos that showcase Lightroom Web and Photoshop Web is because it really brings these apps to a lot of people who might be otherwise intimidated by installing those dedicated desktop apps. This is a great way to get started with Lightroom and with Photoshop, and you can see how they seamlessly connect with each other and expand your photo editing workflow. Now, of course, if you're interested in learning everything there is to know about Lightroom Web, mobile, and desktop, please check out my course called Lightroom Everywhere. It's got almost 11 hours of easy paced lessons. It'll teach you absolutely everything you need to know about it. And I'll leave a link to that in the description below. I also mentioned that I have a video that goes into how to use the point color tool, which is really powerful. So check that out And of course, if you found this video helpful, a thumbs up is very much appreciated, as is clicking on the subscribe button and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.